Telephone presents Helen Parrish on It's a Good Idea. Miss Parrish's guest tonight, Mrs. Edward Arnold and her distinguished actor husband, Edward Arnold.
Hello, I'm Helen Parrish, and this is my new spring hat. Do you like it? Believe it or not, this hat was once worn by Diamond Jim Brady, alias Mr. President Edward Arnold. Very nice to have you with
us. Thank you very much.
And also his charming wife, Mrs. Edward Arnold.
Thank you,
Cleo
Helen.
Arnold.
But
thank
Helen,
you.
I never wore that hat.
Oh, I'm sorry to contradict you, but actually you did, because you see, Cleo made this beautiful lady's bonnet out of one of Edward's old hats. Isn't that right, Cleo?
No, I certainly did, Helen.
You see, this is Cleo's hobby, and actually Edward is just as proud of her hobby of making ladies' hats out of men's hats as she is of his, which happens to be cooking. And I think hobbies are a very good idea. They're lots of fun and relaxing and a release from the nervous tensions of the day. But I never seem to find the time for them, do you? So, of course, the point is that if Mr. and Mrs. Edward Arnold, who are both very prominent and busy people, can find time for hobbies. You see what I mean, don't you? Did you actually make this out of one of his
Helen,
hats?
Yes, Helen, actually. There's your lining and so on.
Oh, I see what you mean.
It started out with this one.
With a hat just like
just
this,
like
yeah.
That. That's a street
Well,
hat.
In just a moment, Cleo's actually going to show us how she does it. But right now, I wanted to bring up the fact that, of course, you all know that Edward Arnold is very prominent as Mr. President on the radio. And I heard a cute story the other day that I think you will appreciate. A friend of mine who teaches second grade asked her pupils who was the President of the United States. And 10 of them said Eisenhower, and 7 of them just shortened it and said Ike. And 1 said Truman, and 2 said Edward Arnold.
Yeah. Well, that's very flattering, I assure you. You know, I really had a ride in Wisconsin.
Do you know, I read about that.
Yeah,
I imagine you're called Mr. President a lot, aren't you?
Yes, we were down at the inaugural, and I was doing some commentating down there at the ball in the armory. And the president happened to go by me just as I was saying some things about him over the microphone. He said, "Hi, Mr. President." I said, "How are you, Mr. President?" Yeah.
Actually, Helen, you'd be surprised the people that address him as Mr. President.
Well, that's a tribute to his wonderful acting, because I know for years you were called Diamond Jim, weren't you?
Yes, I'm glad I lived that down.
Hey, it just occurred to me that if you're Mr. President, that would make Cleo the first lady.
No. Protocol. Madam President.
Oh, Madam President. Yeah. I'm terribly sorry.
With the exception of when I get in his way in the kitchen, and then it's what? Secretary of War.
Oh, now I don't believe that. But we're...
Lean down this way. You're upstaging Helen.
Right now, we're going to get into Edward's hobby later, but right now I want you to actually show us how you can take a man's hat and look at it and figure out some way to make it so attractive.
Well, Helen, as I said, I started out with that, and then this was the hat my shears got into. This is the lining, the inside.
Mm-hmm. You just cut around the brim and take that all out.
Just took the shears and cut around. That's...
Mm-hmm. I'm glad you haven't got another pair of shears, because that hat would go, too.
We'll get to that later, dear. And here it is, Helen. Uh-huh. Then, of course, you just mold the top. Mm-hmm. We're going to make a little pillbox out of this, you see, and turn this around. And, you know, these are lovely to wear with suits.
This is, you start with this, just this basic crown, and you dress it up. Right?
That is all.
You know, I can see, Edward, that you actually, the expression holding onto your hat applies to you, doesn't it?
Every time I come into the house with a new hat, there's a glint in her eye.
Well, it turns out all right, though, dear. This is gray, and then doll it up, the little veil, of course, is red.
Very attractive. There's one that you've already finished. Let's show them that.
It shows the same thing. You can doll them up. Mm-hmm. This is the same hat and the crown. Put a little braid on it and a little nose veil. Isn't that sweet?
Very sweet. But what could you do, for instance, if someone couldn't wear a small hat, didn't have the face for
I thought of that. Look what I found in the closet one day.
Isn't it
gray and soft and shaggy? Isn't it sweet?
I bet you used to like it, too.
Yeah.
I took the band off, Helen, creased it down. Kind of vagabondish, you know. And then I found a belt. A velvet belt.
This is just one of your belts.
That's all, dress belt.
This happens to be chartreuse velvet on the gray hat, which is very stunning.
And of course, I had a chartreuse suit. Thank you, dear. That's very sweet of you.
Do you allow this? Do you allow him to help you?
I actually think you're catching on.
Yeah.
See, I have one problem. I have a husband who doesn't wear hats. What do I do then?
They're encouraging men to wear hats.
Oh, I just encourage him so that I can get a hat.
Yeah, so the ladies can cut them up. The wives can cut them up.
But please be subtle. Don't let him know what you're going to do.
Oh, I see. Make him think it's for him first.
That's right.
You know, that will go beautifully with this gray jacket. May I try it on?
Yes, indeed.
Let me see. Oh, this way. Isn't that smart? Very ingenious, don't you
think? Isn't that sweet, a belt in your old hat, dear?
Hey, that's not a bad idea either. Very tasty.
I'm glad I wear leather belts.
Your belts would be gone, too. You wouldn't have a chance.
Oh, that's sweet.
Just a moment, we're going to give you a chance to talk about your hobby, too. But right now, Hal Gibney would like us to meet someone. She's Miss Marjorie Donahue, who's a telephone operator for Pacific Telephone in Petaluma, California. Hal?
Thank you, Helen. And Marjorie Donahue has come a long way to be with us tonight. Petaluma isn't very far from San Francisco, is it, Marjorie?
No, it isn't, Mr. Gibney. It's about 40 miles north of San Francisco.
And shouldn't I remember Petaluma for some special reason?
I believe so. It's the poultry center of the world.
Yes, it is. A lot of chickens up there, aren't
there? That's right.
Well, tell me about your work at the Pacific Telephone Company.
Well, most of us who work in Petaluma are operators, and we know each other very well, and we have lots of fun together.
Well, being operators, I imagine you get quite a few interesting calls from time to time, don't you?
Yes, we do. We have several calls each day that are a little out of the ordinary.
Do you remember one of them enough to tell us about it tonight?
Well, I had a woman the other day calling. She was having trouble dialing her telephone.
Oh, and she wanted you to explain it to her, is that it?
Yes, she did. She also asked me to watch her dial. She evidently thought we could see her as well as hear her.
Well, I know those switchboards are pretty wonderful things, but so far they haven't had television installed, have they?
No, they haven't. We can only hear the people that are calling.
Even so, it seems to me that being a telephone operator would be a very interesting job. Did you start in with a telephone company when you graduated from school?
No, I didn't. I should have, but instead I took a job that was offered to me in a different field.
Well, I'm happy you changed your mind.
Yes, I did. I had several friends working for the telephone company. And they enjoyed their jobs very much. Mm-hmm. The pay was better than I was getting, so I decided to change.
Well, we're certainly glad you did, Marjorie Donahue, and thanks very much for coming down from Petaluma to be on our program tonight. And now, back to Helen Parrish and Mr. and Mrs. Edward Arnold.
Thank you, Hal, and thank you, Marjorie. Here's another one of those very attractive hats that Cleo Arnold makes out of Edward's old ones. This one is a very dressy one. It was out of a black dress hat. She made it to go with Edward up to San Francisco, where he's going to narrate the show A Night with Rodgers and Hammerstein, which, if I'm not mistaken, is a tribute to their 10 years together.
Ten years together, yes. And they're going to sing all the... There's a chorale group that's going to sing all the songs from the hits that they wrote
like
together.
Like the King and I and Carousel.
King and I, Carousel, and all those things,
wonderful.
You know?
There you're going to start in San Diego.
San Diego, and then we come here to the Philharmonic, and then we go to Bakersfield and to San Francisco for a week.
And you'll be there for a week. Well, everyone will be looking forward to seeing you.
I hope they do, because it's going to be very interesting.
Wonderful music.
And besides narrating it, you know, somebody told me that you're going to sing. Is that true?
I'm not really going to sing. I'm just going to wind up one number.
What's that?
Well, I think it's called...
There's Nothing Like a Dame?
Nothing Like a Dame, you know? And the bass can't hit it low enough, so all I do is...
Better stick to your cooking, dear. Stick to your cooking.
Now, Cleo, I don't mean to be rude, but in this case I agree with you because I'm very anxious to have Edward tell us how he makes this very interesting spaghetti dish.
Yes, how did you make it?
Well, of course, I prepared it before I came down here, but I want to show you how to do it. Everybody knows how to cook spaghetti. Hot water, salt, so on and so on. Now, the ingredients, tuna fish, it's called a tuna fish sauce. Olive oil, parsley, onion, a little celery, and some garlic. These are all chopped together, you see. All chopped together, you put the olive oil in a pan and heat it. After this is all chopped, why then you simmer it until it's all cooked and done. By that time, your spaghetti has been cooked, you see. So you drain it, but you don't blanch it. You know, I don't use any seasoning.
What do you mean?
Well, what I mean by that, I don't use any pepper and salt because I go according to my own taste.
Well, then you do that after you're through.
That's right. If I like it, then the guests should like it. That's all.
I should say so.
Then we put it all in a pan, add the tuna fish, and put it all together, you see. Mm-hmm. And while the spaghetti is draining, why, you put in a little of Parmesan cheese. If it's too dry, add a half a cup of water,
hot
water.
You know, it never would have occurred to me to make a tuna sauce for spaghetti. I think it's very unusual.
You know what's so nice, Helen? It's a quick sauce.
How long does it take? 15 or 20 minutes.
It only takes about 15 or 20 minutes to do.
That's for me. I'm the lazy
Isn't that
type
wonderful?
Cook. May I taste it?
Oh yes, please do.
Oh, I intend to. While I'm doing this, I wish you'd tell everyone how you happened to take up the hobby of cooking. Will you?
Oh well, when I was a youngster, I lived with an uncle of mine who was quite a cook, you see, and I had to help him with the dishes, and he would show me how to cook. In fact, when I first went on the road with the company, I had a big wardrobe trunk.
And in the bottom drawer, I had it fixed up to in compartments, you see. Mm-hmm. And I had a little electric stove, a little smaller than this. And I had compartments for my Worcestershire sauce, my ketchup, my salt, my pepper.
Portable kitchen?
A portable kitchen in the bottom drawer of the trunk. And I'd get it to a hotel. I'd do my shopping, lamb chop, pork chop, steak, anything at all. And I'd use this little electric grill, you see. Of course, I was smart. I had an incense pot with me.
What dish did you use the incense?
I didn't use the incense for any flavoring. But if you cook garlic, you know, there's a little odor there. I was liable to get into the hallway, so I take this incense pot and go up and down the hall, you see, so
you know,
they wouldn't
Helen,
smell
house
the
rules.
Couldn't
so
be found out. I see what you mean. See, how about Edward's cooking? How do you feel about his cooking?
He's a wonderful cook, Helen.
I know. I just tried it. It's wonderful.
But, you know, one of the reasons I think that wives don't encourage husbands to go into the kitchen, it's the cleanup that comes afterwards.
You said it.
You know, with
I
Edward...
Know.
I might as well talk about your good points, dear. He cleans up as he goes along.
Oh, no, what an amazing man. I never heard of such a thing. You're going to make a lot of enemies out there
if
you're not
careful.
Well, maybe.
That's one of the reasons I don't talk about it.
It's not too easy, especially with cup of your cooking utensils.
Well, we're very proud of you, but before we make any more male enemies, I'd like Hal Gibney to tell us about the wonderful job opportunities at Pacific Telephone. Hal?
Thank you very much, Helen. I'd like to tell you more about the many fine job opportunities in vital telephone work. And telephone girls will tell you that these are interesting jobs, too. Let's look in on just a few of them right now. Here's a long-distance operator, for instance. She starts important calls across the nation, even around the world. It must be a thrill to hear a voice 3,000 miles away say, "New York calling." Or let's look at office jobs. Telephone offices are bright and pleasant to work in. You work with friendly associates. And in telephone work, there are many stimulating jobs to choose from. The pay is good, even while you're learning. You'll get regular raises and have fine opportunities for advancement. Many telephone offices have attractive lounges, too, and you'll have a chance to meet nice people. So why not drop in soon and talk it over with the friendly employment counselors at Pacific Telephone? Here's where to go. In Seattle, come to Second and University, or call Mutual 9000. In Tacoma, come to 757 Fawcett Avenue, or call Market 5161. That good job that you've been looking for may be waiting right now at Pacific Telephone. And now back to Helen Parrish and Mr. and Mrs. Arnold.
Thank you, Hal.
I did not put 3 cloves of garlic in that dish. I only put 2 in it.
You know, I think
give me
you
away.
Did. I like it, though.
After all, Helen is sitting close to me, dear.
Oh, no. Well, anyway, it was very tasty, and I happen to like garlic. Marjorie, thank you very much for coming all the way to Petaluma to be our guest tonight. And, of course, Mr. and Mrs. Edward Arnold, as I told you, what such busy people with their hobbies and so on, was wonderful for you to be with us, and we're going to be looking forward to that night with Rodgers and Hammerstein.
You'll enjoy it, I'm quite sure.
I know we will. Cleo, why don't you brag for a minute and tell us about Edward's future pictures?
Well, he's just completed two, Helen. The City That Never Sleeps was one. Oh, and one that's just been previewed in the East now, My Dad, J.R.
I read about that.
I play the father, you know.
Oh, well, I could have figured that out all by myself.
He makes a nice father, too.
You know, it isn't enough with all these hobbies and everything, but Edward also is going to go on a lecture tour throughout the country in the fall. Isn't that right, with all the other things?
That's quite true. After 46 years in this business and doing 102 pictures in the last 21 years, I feel that I've done everything.
I'm sure you have. Well, we've enjoyed having you. And next week, I hope you'll be with us when we'll have an international folk dancing group. Until then, this is Helen Parrish saying goodnight, and meeting you was a good idea.
Next week at this same time, It's a Good Idea brings you Helen Parrish with a program of international folk dances. This is Hal Gibney with a reminder there's a good job for you at Pacific Telephone.